It's Fran again in the lab with, look at this. It's the console from the Space Station Number 5 documentation area of 2001 A Space Odyssey. It's right here in my lab. And it works. It works. Oh, this was so much friggin' work. I started this project in July, and I had the switches constructed and everything. I did the video about making the switches and everything, but actually building the whole panel, this took so many hours. I just was not prepared for how long this would actually take, but it was worth it. It's done. So here we go. This is the shot from the movie. English. It works. Lights up. Yeah. And I have the panel set up so that the zero button is the universal reset for all the for the bus. So hit that and it resets the panel. Because I built a real relay matrix for this, which I'll show later on if you want to stick around and see how I made this. It's going to be a long video of me showing how I made this, all the steps I went through. But basically, it uses relay logic, so I have a real output, switched output for every switch. The keypad is all a momentary contact, but all of the buttons do illuminate as an extra bonus, and they go to their own board. And the language switches are all latching, so I can make selections, you know, as many selections as I want, and reset. Now, wouldn't you know it, I have three incandescent bulbs in every switch, and I went through great pains, and I'll show in the video that I went through, and even like as I was making the switches, I was testing them to make sure that there was no problems or anything, because I knew that once I get it all glued together, I just wasn't going to be able to get it apart again. But after I had the panel assembled, and I was putting the cap tiles on with the lettering and everything, as I was actually gluing the tile down on the Chinese button, one of the incandescent bulbs died. It just died right while I was like finishing it. I was like, too late. but that's part of the, you know, the charm, because in the film, if you examine the film the way I did, you know, looking at every single prop, like, and every single panel, you'll see that all of the panels that have glowy bulbs in them, there are a lot of bulbs that are out. I saw a couple of these long switches that are supposed to have three bulbs in them, and some of them only had, like, one working, so it's sort of in theme with the actual film to have one bulb out. Not that it was planned, but it died, and there you go. Incandescence. but yeah, this was really something to do. It was it's definitely it wasn't exactly like Project Egress, but it didn't have that time pressure, but it did end up in that same sort of area where at the very end of the process it was getting just so. I just wanted it to be over, like so much. So when it got into the final week and a half, I just was so like over with the project, and it wasn't anywhere near done. It's not perfect. There are a few weird things, like the bulb that burned out. It's not perfect, but neither was the original prop, as I showed in the first video. I'm not going to show any clips from that film in this video, because when I made part one, although I had like taken, you know, precautions of like not like taking like a DVD rip or something, and I'm kind of captioning and panning and scanning and stuff, didn't matter. Warner Brothers claimed ownership of the whole video and they monetized it, so. You know, I don't know. It's can't get around that. So I'm not gonna have any frames of that picture. If you want to compare this to the actual prop, go and look at part one of this two-parter. I'm not gonna be showing those again. But this is it. Yeah, it's the I'm running it off my regular bench power supply. I ended up making this a bipolar supply, so it runs off of plus and minus 12 volts with a common. That was because I ended up with using 12 volt relays for the relay logic, but I ran out of 12 volt lamps in my supply bin, and I had just tons and tons of 28 volts. So I just made a split supply, so the lamps are powered on 26 volts ish, and I just use the top end of the supply just to run the relay logic, and that's how I got around it. So yeah, it's go to Italian and Dutch, and there were a few things. I won't show pictures, but the original prop, when it's shown in the film, it's really only this little area here that's shown, and the actor has their hand over the keypad. So the only thing that was real, as far as like the order of the buttons goes, the only number that I could see in the film was the 9 and the 0. So I had to assume that they would have laid this out like a regular phone keypad. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And because in the long shot, you see that there's three sets of three language buttons in the long shot, but in the close up, you only see two rows. So as to what was on the third row, I have no idea. I've searched far and wide for production stills, something of the prop, taken from any angle or anything. I found absolute bupkis. So I just, seeing that in the film, that this would be World Space Station number 5, five big rotating space stations, number 5 being completed, and the idea that English, Dutch, and Russian, French, Italian, and Japanese were the top six. I thought, wow, yeah, that adequately represents the world's population for a world space station. So I just, having just three more choices, I put in Chinese, Hindi, and Portuguese just because, world statistically, I mean, not that these are the nine top languages, because there's like three in here that are definitely not in the top 10 spoken languages, but that this is the way I did it. So I'm giving people from, Asia and people all around the globe who speak Portuguese the chance to be on the space station too, along with everybody else in Europe. So anyway, that's the panel. If you want to stick around, I'll show you how I went and built this working functional prop from the film 2001: A Space Odyssey. And thanks for watching this series, and thanks for watching my channel. Thanks too to all the new subscribers who've been coming along since I rolled over that 100K mark. So welcome and thank you. So here we are with part two of my two-part series of videos about my project to recreate one of the control panels from 2001: A Space Odyssey. And in part one, I detailed the painstaking process of determining the right scale, materials, lettering, and finish for my real-life functional big-ass style incandescent 2001 glowy buttons, and I demonstrated my working prototype of that with the latching resettable relay logic that I would be using in my real reproduction panel. I had the processes pretty well worked out now about how to make all these buttons, so all I had to do was make a bunch of switches, which can only mean one thing. Time for a montage. This is going to be the longest montage I've ever put in a video, but it's going to be worth it. As I said in the previous video, I was going to 3D print the main components of the buttons themselves, which I did in volume. Took several days with my M3 printer to get all of the plungers printed out, and I had to do a little bit of surface refinishing and such. Print out all of the support brackets, which I'm going to have to assemble later some cyanoacrylate glue. So I had all these parts. I spent days and days printing all of the guides, and it was time I had to assemble them into finished guide assemblies using cyanoacrylate glue, putting the two mirrored halves together, bonding them. I found it handy to use a little tool to just sort of smear the glue that overflows just to make a nice smooth interior. Let them dry for a day. Also printed up all of the back plates for the contacts, and putting together the support rails for the long buttons. Same procedure. They're made in two mirrored halves. Use cyanoacrylate glue. Glue them together. Use a tool to sort of smear the overflow. Make it nice and smooth. Let them dry overnight. Yep. And also here I'm printing the smaller back plates for the numerical push buttons on the keypad. I had to cut out those little diffusers that I found was necessary to create the right kind of look inside of the plungers to add another layer of diffusion for the incandescent bulbs to get the right look to make it look like the prop looked in the film. So I cut a bunch of acrylic and all sized exactly the same, and I showed in the previous video how I did this, setting up my bench to do the dulling process to frost the acrylic using my orbital sander. And it's pretty simple. You set up some sticky tape, one piece of tape with the sticky side up, the other two with the sticky side down, so you can have a little sticky area in the middle. Did a few quick passes with the orbital sander on the tops and bottoms, and also on the sides, and the results were very good. Did the same for the long buttons. Just skimmed the tops, skimmed the bottoms, and also did the sides. Worked out really well. I'd say for the camera it looks exactly the same as the sandblasting method that they would have used in the original for the prop in the film. Pretty happy with that. So I got all the diffusers set in all the plungers, and the next step was going to be to begin to create the contact areas. Now I'm using this copper foil adhesive tape, and it solved many problems. Just putting a little X on the bottom right through the hole for the bulb, it'll actually does several things. It creates a nice contact area to meet up with the shoulder of the bulb for the one contact, and also fills in the hole to create a nice tight fit. So holds the bulbs in place and creates the electrical contact. Serves two purposes. And also the copper tape is really easy to solder to, so I'm going to be able to put the bonding wires directly to this tape to create the top parts of the switches. Did the same thing with the three lamp long big ass switches, just, you know, three holes, make three X's in the foil. Push the bulbs through, makes a great tight physical contact and electrical contact with the bulbs. Really worked out great. This system really works well with these mini flange bulbs. Alright, that's all done. So yeah, like I said, the copper foil tape takes solder really well. The trick is to solder very fast, use a lot of flux, because you want to have just very quick contact, because I didn't want to melt the 3D printed part, the PLA part, underneath. So very quick soldering, and speed is the key to making it work. Now, after I had all of the common wires in place, I went through and tested all the lamps and all the bulbs, make sure all the contacts are good, make sure all the filaments are working. I didn't want to have any dead bulbs or any dim bulbs. If there are any bulbs that were missorted, that would be the wrong voltage or something, I want to make sure they'll have the same brightness, that they all turn on. Check each one individually. And they all passed the test. So for the springiness of the switches, two different methods. For the numerical push buttons, I'm using these rectangular pads that I punch a hole in, and that hole is to allow clearance for the contact in the bulb. And for the long, big-ass switches, I'm going to use two square pads, evenly spaced between the bulbs to give the right feel and contact and push back. Before I put the pads on the numerical switches, I'm going to attach the wire for the what's going to be the contact, because I'm using the other contact on the bulb as the contact in the switch as well. This allows me to do the illumination and also to send the outputs to the relay matrix for the switching. Quick test for the feel and the bounce, it feels just about right. Quick test of the fit and of the little numerical switches. I don't have the back contact set up yet, but just feeling to make sure it works, and the feel of it throw feels right, and putting the cap tile on it, it's really starting to come together. So now it's time for me to do the same, put the copper foil on the back plates for the back contacts. Doing the single bulb numerical switches first. I made sure to leave a little bit of the foil over the edge of the switch, because that's where I'm going to solder the wire to and fold that over later. And clamping my power supply to the foil, a quick check to make sure that the contact is going to work. And it does. Just like designed. It's very satisfying. Very satisfying to see that. So now I'm going to go through and solder wires to all of the foils to create the contact for all of the numerical push button switches. Again, just fold that back, and that's going to become part of a bus when I get all the switches in the panel. After getting all the contacts put in, it's time to do final assembly. The bulbs have been tested, the switches are all assembled, and so four spots of cyanoacrylate glue on the backing plate are going to hold the guide assembly in position, and it's true for the smaller switches and also for the three bulb switches. I designed them to work exactly the same way, and the sort of extended feet on the guide assembly allow the clearance for all the contacts and wiring and such underneath and the pads, and also give a little stop for the skirt that's at the bottom of the plunger to hold the plungers in and keep them from coming out. Same process with the big switches. Use the foil for the contact, extend it over the edge a little bit so I could solder the bonding wires on. I did something here. This is for the three lamp switches. I want to connect all of the lamp secondary contacts together into like one universal contact. This again solves many problems. One is it illuminates all the lamps at the same time.
and also gives three opportunities to make contact with the backplate. So if you touch the switch on the side, middle, it doesn't matter. If you push the switch a little bit sideways and only make contact on one side, it'll trigger the relay logic. If you hit it right in the middle, it'll trigger the relay logic. So it makes it consistent for contacts, and also make sure that the bulbs illuminate evenly from the relay logic bus. With the three bulb switches, I found it was going to be easier to put the pads on first, solder the wires second. And again, making sure to have a really good round blob of solder on the top of the bulb, and make sure that the wire contact also has a nice round bulb on it, because that blob of solder is going to end up being the contact with that copper foil on the back plate. So after assembling the wires and soldering, I just clip off the long ends of the wires that are left. And I have to just do that times 9. It's very satisfying, I have to say. It's very pretty. I think that's very pretty. At this point, I'm testing again, making sure that all the solder connections are good, making sure that I have even illumination on all the lamps in case there's a dodgy connection or something. With incandescent lamps, if there's any resistance in the contacts, you'll see a difference in brightness and such. So again, I went through all the switches and tested them again for unity and consistency. I also found it necessary to pair up the plungers with the guide rail assemblies, because there was some variation in the tolerances and printing and assembly and such, and so finding pairs that matched up and went together well was part of the process. And now I'm doing the same thing with these that I did with the shorter switches. It's attaching the wires to the foil, and that's going to become part of the positive bus for all the switches. And then, final commitment, 4 dots of cyanoacrylate glue, and pushing down the guide assembly. Now I have these little sort of guide little rails around the feet, so it kind of snaps in position. It was a very positive contact, so the registration is very tight and it can't wander around. I put a little weight on the top just to hold it for a few minutes until it sets. And this is what I had to do with a few of them, where the tolerances, you know, there were some slight, you know, errors in the printing process around corners and such, where it might bend out a little bit, and just a little bit of filing, a little bit of fitting, a little hand fitting, just to get it so that it's not grabbing or sticking and it's nice and smooth. Again, making sure that I can push the button sideways, you know, just one side or the other, and it'll click. And I did that for all the switches before finally committing to gluing it together. And now I have to start arranging the panel. And I took a photo from the production still from the film, did a perspective drawing so that I could translate measurements with scale and perspective, and calculate out the spacing between the switches and the general size of the panel so I could carve it out of this 3/16 inch piece of black foam core, which is what I assume they used in the original prop. I'm gonna try and make it look exactly the same. And I made all the markings on the inside of the panel. And when you cut foam core, mat board, when you do, you know, this is a very common prop making techniques. Use a cutting table. This is my cutting table. The whole table is a big cutting board. And so you cut right through from the back side to the front, put the face down against the cutting surface, and you're going to cut from the back to the front. Using a Mac cutter and straight edge. In this part of the video, I'm going to be showing lots of different tips and techniques for cutting mat board and foam core, including using sticky tape to hold down the straight rules, and exactly where to plunge in and remove the blades when doing this sort of reverse cutting. It depends on the thickness of the material, the angle of the blade. You sort of have to get a feel for it, make some guides and markings on your tools and such to make sure that when you plunge the blade in and when you pull it out that you're not overshooting the intersections too much. A nice clean cut, you can see right through it. It's nice and clean on the face side. And again, using sticky tape, you just sort of take, I use Scotch Magic tape, roll it up into little rolls, put it on the bottom of the straight edge, and it keeps the straight edge in place so it doesn't wander around on the material. I'm cutting all of the horizontals first, top and bottom side for all the holes. And again, I marked guides on the tool to allow me to see with this particular thickness where the blade will end on the other side of the foam core. And that's the horizontals cut, top and bottom. It should be very clean on the face side. Now again, I've stuck down a smaller ruler. I'm going to use a triangle, square, and to do the verticals. Using the same techniques, sticky tape on the squares. And if you get it close, you see I'm trying to cut as close to the intersection as possible. If you undercut a little bit of hand cutting on the face side just to get right to the intersection. If you go a little shy, that's what you want. Nice clean hole. Quick test with a stack of buttons to make sure the size and spacing is right, and it's right on. Bang on. Perfect. Okay. Very happy with that. So I'm just going to continue again with the same procedures for cutting out the rest of the keypad buttonholes. Checking along the way. Just gotta make sure. If you make a mistake in this, you gotta start over. That's why I'm being extremely careful. Double checking everything, checking the measurements and markings, clarifying things as I go. If you're putting hours into doing a piece like this, you know, one miscut, one overshoot, you'll probably just abandon the whole thing and start over again. So being quite careful to get it just right. Oh, that's very satisfying when you cut a mat just right and you just pop it out with one finger. And there you go. So the numerical keypads are all cut. Really looks like the real prop, I gotta say. Coming together. So I'm going to extend the same process to cut the larger openings for the translation language button holes. Again, checking with the stack of buttons, making sure that the fit and spacing is correct. I couldn't help but just trying to see what this is going to look like, so just stacking up some cap tiles just to get a general feel. Oh, that looks so nice. It's just really coming together. I'm checking every step of the way because, as I said, if you really make a mistake or if you overcut or undercut or make an error, you might have to make an adjustment or abandon it. But I didn't make any mistakes. It looks good. All I have to do now is do final sizing because it's oversized to make it easier to cut out the holes. But now I have to cut the trim and get it down to actual size to go into the panel assembly. Here's a trick for the straight edge. You take a piece of scrap if you want to cut close to an edge, and you'll see me do this a lot with cutting all these parts, using pieces of scrap to build up the work area to stabilize straight edges. Also, they're handy to use for overshoot when you're cutting off the end, to put a little piece of scrap on the end if you need to catch the blade if you're doing a short piece. Piece of plywood scrap just to act as a nice straight edge to, again, square up on the panel. Here you see I used a piece of scrap for the overshoot. It's another common thing. These are all really basic prop making tricks because foam core, it's a universal material for prop making. I've been using it for 30 years, making all kinds of props, and it's indispensable. It looks solid and it's easy to cut, so it's great for props. There you go. Oh, the main panel is cut and ready, so I'm going to set that aside and move on to the support structure. Now, I have to create a base for the panel because it's at a slight angle, so I'm going to have to angle the base that the switches are going to be mounted on that are going to go through the panel at the same angle. So I've made a template for the angle as a master angle reference piece, which is over there on the top left, and I'm using that to construct a base. And I came up with these little angled shims and making a set of four of them that are going to act as sort of a foot support for a piece which is going to become the base for the switches. And making four of these little angled feet, that's going to be the base of the entire panel assembly. I'm cutting out from a piece of half-inch foam core, which is much more rigid. I'm cutting the base for the whole panel assembly, marking it for where these little support feet will go, and I'm going to glue them down on the bottom. I'm not going to put them towards the outside because I'm going to have outside pieces that it's going to be glued to separately. So it'll end up having six individual mounting points throughout the base, so it'll be very secure. And the half-inch foam core is really rigid, so it's going to be more than adequate to take the brunt of pushing switches and not. I'll let that dry for a while. Now I'm going to cut a piece that's going to become part of the front of the panel assembly. It'll sort of make sense when you see it coming together. But the panel assembly is going to be created from the base piece, the top panel cover, which I just finished. It's going to be two side pieces and a front piece that's sort of going to connect all those pieces, and there's going to be a top panel piece that I'll make last. Now here's one of the things about foam core. When you cut it open, you expose the foam core, and so to get a finished top piece, to get a finished surface, you have to dress that. So in order to do that, I've got some sheet newsprint, which is going to, it's about the same thickness as the outer paper surface of the foam core. I'm going to cut some strips to make up surface pieces, like a veneer, basically. Well, it is a veneer. To finish and dress the exposed foam core edges of these pieces I'm cutting for the panel to give it the appearance of a finished solid piece. Again, these are really basic prop making techniques. So I'm using glue stick, great stuff. It's a white glue combined with a contact adhesive, so it's sticky. Great stuff, but it sets up very fast, which is a good thing because it allows you a really quick working time. You don't have to let stuff dry overnight before you can actually, you know, use it. Use a roller to flatten it out completely against the foam surface. Give it like a half hour to dry. And then going back with an X-Acto knife and very carefully with the right angle, cut up right against the foam core to trim off the excess. Do that on all sides. And the end result is that it looks complete all around. Looks indistinguishable from malmine. I'm just sizing this piece now because I made it a little oversized, and now I have to size it down to be exactly the same width as the panel face piece that I just cut, because the two are going to go together to form the inner core of the panel assembly. So to make sure I get it right, use one to make the other, and so the panel that I cut is going to be used as the reference master to cut all of the other parts that are going to fit on the interior, so everything is going to be square and true. Alright, so here's the base and the top panel and that front piece. That's how it's going to go together. And it all fits together pretty well. Looks good. So now I have to cut two pieces to act as side rails as part of this panel assembly. And using the master template, I'm going to cut both of them from the same piece, because if you use the same hypotenuse to cut between the different triangular pieces, you're using that same angle as the top on both. They'll be identical, and the only thing you have to do to size them is trim their height. So, another kind of a basic trick of making things geometrically identical when you have complex angles. So there you go. It has exactly the same angle. I just have to trim one to be the same height. Get them to be identical all around. So again, when you're cutting these smaller pieces, using scraps to build up the work surface, again, to stabilize the cutter, straight edge, and have a little place for the tool to go out over the work, makes it all possible and easy. And there you go, those are the two side rails. But again, I have exposed the foam core, and so at least on three sides, I want these to look like solid finished pieces. So I'm going to cut more strips of paper and do the same technique that I did for that front piece. I'm gonna cut some strips to size for the various sides. It's going to be the back, front, and top of both of these pieces. Marvelous, wonderful glue stick. Great stuff. And like I said, the key is to work fast because it sets up really quick, especially with really porous materials. Use a roller to get it flat. Doing the other one. And again, you know, like 20 minutes is usually plenty of time for that to dry enough to trim it back. If you feel it with your finger, just feel the paper, if it feels damp or moist, you won't want to cut it because you want it to be dry, but once you feel it that it doesn't feel moist or damp, it's ready to go, and you just trim off the excess. Same thing with the short end. Trimming again. Now doing the trimming with X-Acto, it's really just, if you know the tool, it's just a very specific kind of angle that you can feel with the blade, that you've got it at the correct angle and tuck it right up against the foam core, just cuts right flush. Yep. All that's left to do is to do the top side. I have to say, I really love having a really big cutting table. I use it all the time for every project. It's just indispensable, just having a table that you can just cut right into. And there you go, it's complete. Looks solid all around. It's all finished with edging. Perfect for a prop. Alright, so now it's time to see what this is all going to look like coming together. Final check to make sure that everything fits and is square. I'm drawing some guidelines on the backing piece. Show where the switches are going to be mounted to allow me to put some glue in the right spots when I do the final assembly. I was originally going to do this in a much more complicated way, so I took precautions and made guides and stuff because I was going to originally put them on the backing piece first, and it just really turned out to be an alignment nightmare, and I, at the last minute, changed the technique and decided that I'd build the panel in reverse against the front panel and then glue it to the back plate last. And this really seemed to be the easiest and least problematic way of putting this all together. So I'm using double-sided tape on the inside of the front part of the panel, and I'm going to align the switches, sticking them to the tape against the front of the panel on the inside, and do all the wiring and everything into the top part of the panel rather than doing it from the bottom part as I originally thought I was going to do. It just turned out that this was going to be the easiest way to keep everything in alignment and to be able to make sure that when I do the final assembly that it's all going to come together with the least problems and the lowest probability of having headaches or last-minute catastrophic mistakes in the assembly. Some of the stuff I'm just going to speed up and just kind of show the process at 4x speed. It's not really evident here, but one of the things I did to make this possible is I made a couple of little guide blocks, which I keep moving and setting on either side of the switches to support the foam core while I'm pushing down on the switches. Again, I was really careful that I didn't want to deform or break or dent or crack the panel while I was trying to assemble it. Yeah. At this point too, the whole panel is actually getting kind of heavy, so it was evident that I was going to have to add some support brackets, like a piece of foam core to bracket on the inside, which I do add in a little bit. But I'm going to be creating the buses for the switches, which I'm going to be putting into a big wire harness assembly. All of the back switches, all the back contacts, are all going to be put into one common bus. Turned out that there was actually going to be two buses and then the outputs for the switches, because as I mentioned in part one, I ended up making this into a bipolar system because I'm using 12 volt relays, which I had many of them in stock for the relay logic, but I didn't have very many 12 volt lamps in this style, but I had lots of 28 volt lamps, which I'm running slightly under power to get the right look and sort of color temperature. So I'm going to run them at about 26 volts for the total voltage on the lamps, and I'm just using the 12 volt bus on the bipolar supply for the relay logic. And there it's with the support bracket attached, which really turned out to be necessary, but with that one piece of half inch foam core glued down, the front panel is now very rigid and I'm not in any danger of breaking it by handling it. I also put in these little foam core towers to separate the plus and minus 26 volt bus with some air gap. Just using a piece of tape over the top part, I basically glued the little towers on top of the one bus and I'm putting tape over the top of the other. So basically it's just creating an airspace to keep them separate. This is sort of the foam core version of point-to-point wiring techniques, just using airspace to keep everything where it should be. But those are the two buses just for the lamps. And so each of the contacts on the plungers has an individual output that I'm going to have to individually wire to a header assembly, which is going to be used to interface with the relay matrix board. I also found it handy just to number the switches because this is upside down and backwards, so I kind of want to make sure that I get everything in the right order when I start to wire everything to the headers for the bus. Now came the time for me to actually assemble the circuit board. First thing I had to do was to make a set of headers, one side of which would be connected to all of the switch contacts, and the other would be soldered right to the breadboard that would actually interface with the relay logic. I've always found it's handy to do it this way by assembling the two pieces together just to get the alignment just right. It's really the only way to do it. And there you go, two pieces. So every single switch contact is going to be wired to a pin on the header. Now when I made the switches, I used short wires for the switch contacts. I really was not sure exactly how I was going to wire this up when I got in the final assembly, but I knew that I'd have to have some kind of wiring harness and to extend these wires, which I did using my standard stock Teflon wiring. I use Teflon wire because I've got lots of it, and I like it. I like the fact you can't melt the insulation. And just with some really good fitting tube to act as an insulator, slide it over the connection. I'm using the heavier gauge wire for the three bulb switches just because of the current draw. Using some cable ties to make up a nice little wiring harness. And it's pretty much done. The panel's all wired up. Looks pretty, I must say. So this is my original sketch for the relay logic, which I prototyped in the first video using these 12-volt double-pole, double-throw little single-coil relays. They have a really nice small footprint. And so I'm making up a matrix of 11 relays. One relay to act as a flip-flop for each of the switches, and one relay to be a universal resetting bus, which is going to be connected to the zero on the numerical keypad. The idea being that each flip-flop uses a single bus for its latching, and that bus is connected to the reset relay, and pushing the zero throws that one relay, which cuts out the reset bus and resets all the flip-flops that are engaged on the panel. Now I'm not going to go through like all of the assembly of this board because it's a lot of redundant stuff. Basically, one big ground bus for all the relays and one big positive bus for all the for the hold and the latching for the logic, and then wiring up each of the positive terminals of the relays to the header to interface with the switches, and that's pretty much it. Looks pretty, must say. Looks very pretty. Okay, so here it is. The first test. I got it all wired up. Dual supply. First time trying it out. Power up. All right, we have latching. And reset. It works. It works. Was there ever any doubt? Okay, time to try combinations. Let's try two selections. All right, and reset, it works. All right, all of the push buttons on the numerical keypad, they all light up. Got power to all the contacts, testing all the bulbs. I went through and tested different combinations of switches. Every combination works, all the bulbs work, all the contacts make contact, perfect. 100% functional. Very happy, it's done. So the panel works. Now all I have to do is assemble the case to get the whole thing finished, just the cosmetics. So we're just going to glue it all together. All right, setting the panel in. I'm going to put that in place so that when I glue the side pieces that everything's aligned, it's all going to fit. Also using some scrap pieces to get the right offset because I noticed that with the prop and the film, it looked like the offset of that front piece was equivalent to the thickness of the stock that they were using, so I'm doing the same thing. And, you know, I thought all kinds of different ways of gluing down the panel using all kinds of different adhesives, and I ended up just going with glue stick because it does have that contact adhesive in it, and it will hold the switches in place good enough to withstand what I'm going to put it through and just demonstrating the prop. I also wanted to make it possible to reverse the process and pull the panel out if I ever wanted to modify it or repair it in the future. So with the glue stick, it would be possible to pry that panel out without maybe destroying the prop if I used, like, you know, a strong glue. I So the side panels are glued on. The last thing I have to do is create a cover for the remaining part of the panel. So I'm just going to cut a piece out of 3/16 inch white foam core to match what's in the prop in the movie. And I'm going to size that down to fit really tightly in the remaining space. I'm also using some scrap pieces to make some side rails to hold this new piece in, and using another piece of 3/16 inch scrap just to align it, make sure that it's going to be where I want it, and using some push pins to hold it in place while the glue dries. This is another tried and true prop making technique with working with the foam core, using push pins to hold pieces in place while they're being glued. And I also put this right angle piece in the back to make it rigid so that it will keep its shape and won't cave in. Fits in nice and snug. So the panel is done. Cosmetically, it's done and it functions. All I have to do is do the cap tiles. So to do this, I'm taking a spare tile and marking it so that I can use this as a guide to be able to mark the printed vellum sheets that I showed in part one to have the lettering. And I'm doing this so that I will know exactly how and where to cut and align each of the tags with the printing on it to get them centered and correct on each tile so I don't have to guess. Putting these guides on this sample tile, I can just put it over top of the vellum, line it up exactly where I want it to be on the finish button, and then marking around that sample tile, I'll know exactly where to cut it out, and I'm also going to use these outlines to align the text on top of the cap tiles with my light box before I do the burnishing. Same thing with the numerical keypad. I have a little spare button that I use to make up the alignment marks for the individual numerical keys. And I really figured that this was going to save me an awful lot of headache in the final assembly. I wouldn't have to guess or eyeball exactly where center is. I would just have to use the guidelines. And I'm ready to go. Again, using the cutting table, indispensable, rotary cutter, kind of standard for paper and fabric. Just using the rotary cutter to cut out the strips of this printable vellum. And just releasing the individual lettering and numbering, and using my tried and true light box, which I made way, 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 way back in the 80s when I was a teenager. I've showed this before. Still serves me very well today, I must say. So again, using those alignment marks, being able to look through the whole thing. Just using a finger to get it started and get the bubbles out. Make sure you don't get bubbles trapped in there. Cut off the excess as much as I can. And then laying down a transparency to protect the vellum from damage while I'm burnishing it using a burnishing tool. It's basically getting all the air out and making good contact all around. And I do this with all the tiles. One of the artifacts shows up in this one, the English. You see that little diagonal line? This is an artifact of these vellum sheets. It was a compromise. It's not perfect, but Avery, when they make these raw sheets, they sort of indent in these diagonal lines to make it easier to take the backing off. Unfortunately, it distresses the adhesive and the vellum, and so when you actually get it burnished, it shows through as a flaw where the vellum has been slightly crushed by the production process. And unfortunately, these diagonal lines go all through the paper, so there's no way to avoid it getting on some of the labels. So it just happened to end up on the English. Using the same techniques, with a little help from a little screwdriver, to get the labels on the small numerical tiles. Again, using a transparency to protect it while burnishing. So I've got the vellum stuck down on all the tiles, and now I have to do is trim them down. And again, you're just using a little straight edge that I'm put a little bit of rolled tape on just to keep it in place. I'm putting it right up to the edge of the tile, just trimming it off each side one at a time, taking care to make sure that I get the alignment right. They're finished. Just do that for all of the buttons. So, going by the pictures from the original film to my versions that are done with a different technique, I tell you, it just looks really, really good. So now it's come down to the wire. I've got to glue them in place. And so to make it all possible, I'm taping down this little guide strip, and I'm putting it to a very specific distance from the switches that I'm going to use as a base to align all of the switches. I figured if I glue the bottom switch in exactly the right position for each of the locations across the panel, then I can stack up the switches on top of that using the first tile as a reference, and it'll all be aligned and tight and right on measurement. So to make it easy on myself, again, without the light boxes, I illuminate the switch that I'm going to put the tile on. I put a perimeter of cyanoacrylic glue around the top of the plunger, and then using the illuminated box of the plunger to align the tile, the top tile, get it in place, again making sure that it looks right all around, that it still functions, I'm pushing it a little bit, and then having that first tile in place, I then use that as a position to align the subsequent tiles that go on up. So I stack them one at a time. Again, following the procedure, illuminating the button, putting the cyanoacrylate glue down, putting the next tile on, and just making sure I have a little bit of clearance between the two tiles. I'm pushing on a little bit to make sure they don't rub together. And then doing the third. Bit of tremor. My tremor showing up when I tried to do this really high detail work. It really shows up. Let that dry. There we go. I'm gonna speed this part up. This was definitely the most nerve-wracking part because I knew that if I made any mistakes at this point, if I glued something down crooked and tried to pry it off, if I broke a switch, misaligning it, if I did any mistakes at this point, I'd be trashing the whole project. And so I was under high stress and getting this just right. But again, checking everything, checking the switches, illuminating them, putting the tiles on. And as I had pointed out in the first video, As I was doing this very technique on the very far right set of buttons, as I was putting down the very last tile for the Chinese button, one of the lamps in the Chinese button gave out. That far left lamp just died while I was gluing it down. It was just classic Murphy's Law. But what are you gonna do? So this was the only button that I really had to eyeball. I didn't have a guide set up for it. I just kind of eyeballed the zero. But I'm for the other rows of numerical keys, I'm doing the same process of aligning to the guide that I stuck down with tape, and then just establishing a column of tiles. Again, testing the tolerance between the different tiles, making sure that the buttons click, that they're not really grabbing each other. And I'm doing that while the glue is setting, so that make sure that I, you know, can put in a little bit of wiggle room between the switches, so that they work just right. And the final tile. One last check, and they're all done. Just gotta dry. Take off the guide and go. Putting the top panel on, and it is done! It's done! Ah, finally. Well, that's it. That's it for this one. Thanks for watching, and thanks too to all of my patrons. You know, this channel only operates because of Patreon. In fact, if you like this content, if you like the kind of stuff I do, consider becoming a patron. It's what makes all of these videos possible. This project would not have happened without the support of all my patrons on Patreon. If you want to support the channel, it's easy to do. You just follow the link in the description, become a patron. All right. Thanks. I'm Fran. I'll see you back in the lab and on the space station real soon. Bye! Now all I had to do was da la ba ba la doo. Alright. Day in, day out, day in, day out, day in, day out, day in, day out. In the can! Montage, gonna do a montage. Gonna see a lot of stuff going on. It's getting better every time. Lots of stuff going on in the montage. That's what we're gonna do. Gonna see it getting better. See it come together. It's getting better in the montage.